We ready, everybody?
Yes, sir.
Good evening, everybody. I'd like to call tonight's meeting to order. Today is Tuesday, September 27th, 2016. It is 7 o'clock. We have a board meeting. Following the board meeting, we will have a committee of the whole meeting as well. Our first order is the Pledge of Allegiance, and I'd ask everyone to please stand.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Jessica, would you please call the roll this evening?
Present.
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 Present. We have a quorum, and thank you all for attending this evening. Janet, do we have any presentations this evening?
We do not.
Okay, our next item is public comments, but before we go into the public comments, I'd like to acknowledge Mayor Richard Scheck from the Village of North Riverside, our neighbor to the east. Welcome, sir. Okay, we have a lot of visitors this evening, and to give as many visitors as possible an opportunity to speak, in the interest of adjourning by 9, please limit your comments to 3 minutes in length unless further time granted by the board. Comments on active agenda or general matters. I think our clerk, since we have such a host, we filled out forms as well, and you are requesting spellings of names for the minutes. Is that not correct? Okay. So, if you wish to address the board, please line up on the what would be your left, our right, and fire away.
Okay, I timed this at about 3 minutes and 10 seconds, so I'm going to talk fast. Village President Sam Puglia, board and staff members of Westchester, thank you all for coming tonight and letting our voice, the voice of the people of Westchester, be heard. Ordinance number 15-2115 creates a lose-lose.
I'm sorry, sir, could you state your name?
I'm Lou Yolen.
Lou Yolen, thank you.
Yes. Ordinance number 15-2115 creates a lose-lose, self-destructive environment for the people and the village of Westchester. I've outlined several specific reasons why this ordinance should be overturned. One, the Westchester Fire Department says the reason they passed this ordinance is for safety reasons. I did the research. There literally has not been a single fire in 4-unit and above properties in Westchester in over 20 years to yield any need for change. Most of these buildings are brick on the inside, brick on the outside. As the saying goes, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. The commercial alarm systems are thus unnecessary. The way the buildings have been works great, are very safe, there's no need to change it. Two, installing these fire alarm systems will cost around $7,000 and up per building to install, plus around $50 per month forever for the service. Speaking for myself, I simply can't afford this. And we're already bogged down with bills, increasing property taxes, the poor sewage system, and flood problems in Westchester. We don't need any additional unnecessary expenses. This may force some of us into foreclosure, bankruptcy, etc., which will drive down Westchester property value and hurt everyone involved. Some specific homeowners who are here tonight and hopefully will speak are cancer patients, and every cent they have goes towards their medical treatments. If this ordinance is not overturned, they may not be able to afford their medical expenses and may not survive. Three, the city of Chicago requires the same alarm system only for buildings 20 units and above. It's unacceptable that Westchester is requiring them for much smaller buildings, 4 units and up. Four. This is actually creating more of a safety hazard than helping. Technology is known to fail. People may rely on this new alarm system to inform the fire department of a potential fire and not call them manually to notify them as we do now. If the alarm system fails or breaks, the fire department may never be alerted of the fire and much more damage can result. This also makes the fire department liable. If there's a fire and the alarm system doesn't work, you're shooting yourselves in the foot, creating a whole new set of liability issues for the Westchester Fire Department. Almost done. We all want to improve the village of Westchester. It's in all of our best interest to increase property value and safety. This ordinance is going to drive down the property value and safety, lower the quality of life in Westchester, bring in more riffraff to an already increasing village crime problem, and create a more dangerous environment. We are here today to say no to ordinance 15-2115, and demand that it's overturned. We are the people of Westchester. This is our will. This is our voice. We'd rather the village focus their attention on matters we actually need that will actually increase village safety and property value, like fixing the sewers, paving the alleys, reducing crime, etc. I'm also going to hand you, President Puglia now with petitions from a majority of homeowners this affects who want to see this ordinance overturned. Should I hand it to the police?
Let's give it to our clerk. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Earl Ellison. This, we're in a four-unit condo. It's going to it has already cost us over $2,000 a unit for this ugly, outdated monstrosity to be put in. And where the fire really would occur, should there ever be one here, it would normally be in someone's kitchen. This is in a hallway. Are we looking for somebody to firebomb our stairs? I mean, that's what this system is for, okay? People cannot afford it. I cannot afford it. And it smacks that the prior administration, let's say, was corrupt in putting this in here, and that stink is spreading among us all if you don't reverse this.
Good evening.
Hello.
Ready for me? I'm Teresa Birdsmith, and I'm here to talk about something that's near and dear to my heart, other than the fire ordinance. And that is, I would like to know who's responsible for the plethora of weeds that have overtaken the sidewalks on Wolf Road, particularly between the blocks of Lancaster and Wakefield. I am a runner. I'm out every day. There are weeds that are as high as 3 foot. There are broken tree limbs that hang over the fences. I find myself having to walk out into the street, run out into the street in order to get around it. I called the village, nothing was done. They told me that the county was responsible, that they would take care of it. In addition, Wolf Road is a busy street. It does not speak well of Westchester. It looks terrible, and I would think that we would want it taken care of. It's unattractive, it's unsafe, and it makes me and other runners very unhappy.
Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Amanda Grant, 1356 Hydorn. I'm here today actually because I'm the co-director of the Westchester Food Pantry, and something has come up recently. Next year, we'd like to change our service model for how things are done, and I wanted to formally ask the trustees, I know you were considering it, about our use of the community room each Wednesday night next year. So basically, I'm here to, I can state what we do. I think you're all really familiar with the food pantry. Everyone here has been just super supportive. Westchester has just a great community. Speaking from the food pantry perspective, we have clients here and we also have donors here. We have a wonderful community, and I'd really like to turn this into the best possible food pantry it can be. So we are respectfully asking that next Wednesday, next year, we start serving clients only on Wednesday nights.
I think we'll have to schedule that, you know, through the proper channels to see what else we may have or what day or whatever. Is it every Wednesday night or one Wednesday night a month? And one of the things I was going to express to you is, and I understand that, you know, we've taken on a host of other communities, but I'm hoping that other communities are donating food to our pantry that we can give out. I mean, generally this pantry was started for those in Westchester that were in need, and we never really turned anybody away. But I did understand that a neighboring community has a food pantry, but for some reason they're not going there, they're coming here, and I find that a little bit odd. I don't mind helping anyone in need, but I'm hoping that the communities that we've touched, that you've expanded this to, are also bringing food in here, that it's not just Westchester people, and then we're
Of course.
Going crazy trying to feed the masses. And I looked in there the other day, and it's bare bone about what's inside that situation here. So I'm hoping that, you know, people from Western Springs and wherever we touch are just not sending people here, that they're also helping in the regard as well.
Right. Well, truthfully, the majority of our clientele, for those of you who don't know, Westchester Food Pantry has been in existence for over 20 years. Just last year, a friend and I took over for it. And before, it's true, it was started mostly for Westchester people, but they did not turn away anyone. That means they were serving people from Chicago or whoever happened to come. Since we have come, we have defined a service area. You do have to show proof of residency to receive food. The majority of our clients do come from Westchester and then our neighboring communities of Bellwood, Broadview, and Hillside, although our service area does also include Oak Brook, Westchester, and LaGrange Park. As you can imagine, we don't get many clients from there. We are reaching out to these other places. We reach out to schools, we reach out to community groups, we reach out to senior centers, and we reach out to area churches in the communities to ask them to support us. However, and this is one of the reasons why we would really like the room for this one set night each week next year, this week we have a meeting with the Greater Chicago Food Depository. In the past, this food pantry has run only on donations of the kindness of people who live in this area. However, getting us involved with the Greater Chicago Food Depository, once we become an affiliate, we will get food from them. And they are the ones who get food from corporations like Kraft and Nabisco. They are the ones who get food from grocery stores, Jewel, Mariano's, Trader Joe's, Costco. They are the ones who get all the donations that otherwise we would be asking for. The benefit of belonging to a greater organization such as this lets them focus on getting the food and lets us serve our clients, which are people in our communities. One of the requirements to be involved with the Greater Chicago Food Depository is we have to be open 2 hours each week. We are asking for the ease of our clients. We are asking, you know, and again, for the ease of our community. Right now, it takes a toll on the village staff who, you know, we're so grateful for them. They actually help out with the food pantry. But we would like to take that responsibility off of their shoulders. They have enough to do. By keeping us open 2 hours each night next year, starting in 2017, this would allow us to get to know our clients more. This would allow us to decide if there are other services that we could possibly helping them with, such as SNAP benefits, which is food stamps. Maybe they need job training. Maybe they need, you know, assistance filling out forms for school. Those are things that we could possibly help them with if we were able to get to know our clientele better, which we could do if it's food pantry volunteers serving food pantry clients.
And just be mindful because, you know, we're not going to have another episode if all this food is coming in here that it's going to take over the community room, because the community room is used for a number of events. And we're not going to have food and boxes and all this stuff stored out in the open there. And you well know that the room that you're in came from a garage where the mice were eating some of the food to an indoor closet. It's not
right.
It's not that big. So
the walk-in closet is definitely a step up from being outside in the cold. Keep in mind, though, that as we have changed the food pantry so much in the past year and a half to become a 501c3, to have our own website, to have a defined service area and defined client applications where people are telling us, you know, do you have small children? Are there elderly people on the home? Are there veterans that we could also link up with other programs? As we're making these changes, we are thinking of our growth. Eventually, and love the Village Hall, we would like our own space. But these things happen in steps, and one of those things that can also come as being part of the Greater Chicago Food Depository Network is assistance to one day have a place of our own where we take this off of your shoulders. We would love to do that. If there's any realtor, anyone has any space they'd like to let us have in return for a tax, yeah. I'm sorry, you're right.
So, but thank you. I mean, again, we're going to work with you.
Please,
you know that.
It.
But
please,
again, you know, there's some restrictions that we have to impose as well.
Right.
Because there's other people that use the room.
Right. Absolutely. Please consider it. Thank you, everyone.
All right. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Judy Sheck, and I've been a owner of one of the buildings that was notified that we have to put in the fire alarm system, which I think is totally ridiculous. These buildings have brick interior walls, let alone exterior. They're only two stories, and it just seems like a burden on everybody that owns these buildings to have to do this. For not a good reason, that's the main thing. These are not high rises, these are not, you know, unfair. And another thing I'd like to know, is Westchester home rule?
No.
Yep. Well, if you're not home rule, then I don't think, and I'm not an authority, but I don't think you had the authority to make this ordinance because you are not home rule. And my other thing is, everybody loves Westchester and wants to see it safe and fine, but I think this plan was bad from the beginning. And one other thing, none of us, as you can see how many people turned out for this, were ever notified that there was a possibility that this was even being thought of. We got a letter saying we had to do it. We had no say, no nothing. So that's it. Thanks for your time.
No, we'll wait till we get through and then Jim will comment.
Good evening. My name is Renato Javier. I have a four-unit building in Mannheim and Canterbury. I'm 70 years old, live in Westchester since 1979. I haven't experienced a single four-unit fire. I maintain my building. I spend a lot of money to maintain it. I'm retired. I'm 70 years old, and I just plain cannot afford what you're proposing today. I hope you reconsider your requirements. Thank you.
Thank you.
Purchased the unit, and I'm sure I am one of many that are on a limited income. I just lost my job 2 months ago, and you know, I know I can get another job, but to have this type of price put on us, and again, no warning, no nothing, to me, I find it to be very disrespectful. And I'm sure, you know, I may not speak for everyone, but I think it's very disrespectful because I myself, I value my neighbors, and especially my seniors. They are so dear to my heart, and I hate when anyone tries to give them the shaft. I don't like it, and I really wish you guys could reconsider that ordinance, because it's very unfair to the community.
Hello, my name is Rita Calero, and I live on Westchester, 22nd Street.
Ma'am, could you speak into the microphone?
Sorry. Anyway, I was told that we have to put an alarm system in our building. I turned around, and there were people working in our building, like 3 weeks later, and put the alarm in. It looks like a war zone in our hallways. It's terrible. I don't have $2,000 to give anybody. I have cancer. I have lung out. I have aneurysms in my head. I have high blood pressure, 3 ribs taken out. Doctors, I got 4 doctors, 4 hospitals. I'm still paying for 7 years. I don't have $2,000. What do I do? Move? Do I leave? Where am I going to go? Who's going to buy my property? I just got it. I just got it 2 years ago. Who's going to come and buy my property? Nobody. Not when they see what's going on there. I'm a senior. I only get Social Security. Where am I going to get the $2,000 to give you people? I don't have it. What do I do? Somebody told me, go get a charge card. I'm 76 years old. Why should I go get a charge card? I got enough bills. I can't pay it. We're all seniors, we're all sick, we all have bills. Why are you doing this? We know what we're doing. We're not gonna have a fire, and if we do, we got smoke alarms all over our houses, in our hallways. It's a dirty shame what you are doing to seniors. You ought to help us, not hurt us. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Terry Cornell. I live at 1441 Balmoral. As you can see, I'm here to say basically the same thing everyone else said. I don't have the money. I became disabled in January. And right now, I'm living off of my savings, and I cannot find $2,000 in addition to my association fees to pay on a continuous basis. I don't know when I'm gonna get a job, which I doubt if I do. And I have, just like she said, I have hospital bills just pounding up, and I just can't afford it. We have in our unit, as everyone say, they are brick. We have smoke detectors in all the hallways, in all the units. We have carbon monoxide detectors all over the building. If one of my neighbors, their alarm go off, I'm hearing it. You know, we have the fan just to keep people from calling the fire department. So at this point, I just don't understand it. And I'm like the other lady, I just purchased this place 2 years or 3 years ago. And who's gonna buy it? No one's gonna buy it. Not even, it's even hard. I done tried to sell it, trust me. And no one is, there's no takers for it at this point. And I'm with everyone else. I just can't afford it. I don't see the sense in it. And if he said 20 years, if there's a fire, I'm quite sure someone somewhere will be able to call a fire department. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Scott Ryerson, and I live in Dickens Street at Westchester. And I'm also here to argue against ordinance number 15-2115. I represent the Balmoral Condo Association. There are 10 of our buildings, which makes us 40 unit owners. We have in place fire extinguishers, smoke alarms, carbon monoxide detectors on every floor, emergency lighting in all the common areas. The last time I checked, it would cost us over $100,000 to retrofit our association. This will probably cause us to go into dissolution and bankruptcy. At our last meeting between the board of directors of our association, we voted that as of the May 17th deadline, we will not be in compliance with this ordinance. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Alex Loftus. Lou Yellen invited me to be here. You've heard a lot about how it's not right, it's morally wrong, it's burdensome. I want to explain to you how this is illegal. I'm an attorney and this is my area of practice. The issue is it's more complicated than just, you know, you ask people to put in safety alarms, so they do. The problem is that you're asking them to pay more than they should, and you're asking them to only choose from one provider. It's you know, antitrust laws, which apply to monopolies of businesses, that applies to the village. So under the Sherman Antitrust Act, any restraint of trade, such as this, which says you can only use SMG and no one else, and when you use them, you need to pay 3 times more than you would pay to another provider, that's illegal. It's a violation of the Sherman Antitrust Act. The damages for that the village would then be on the hook for, along with SMG, would be 3 times the loss for any individual. The loss for any individual is each month they pay, was it $70 instead of 10? They get $10 for ADT, then so they pay 70. So $60 a month per user times 3 into the Sherman Antitrust Act, plus you have to pay me to litigate the case. Now, the idea of an antitrust case and something like this is hard to understand. I appreciate. What you can appreciate is that the Village of Lisle got sued for the same thing. The Village of Lisle paid out $1.2 million in attorney's fees. And that's not what they paid to defend themselves from this. So the benefit of $13.50 quarterly that you're getting from SMG compared to the potential liability for even just one homeowner doesn't make economic sense. And it certainly doesn't make economic sense. sense if you have a class action on behalf of all the people in the community affected by this that are rounded up together and already have an attorney ready to go and ready to proceed with all these claims. Because not only is there the Sherman Antitrust Act and the Clayton Antitrust, there's potential for an attempt to monopolize claim, which is a larger claim, it's more complicated to prove. There's a Sherman Class 1 claim, and the Sherman Type 1, that is just simply the creating the ordinance that is a restraint of trade. There's a potential Fifth Amendment violation. If we assume there's a Fifth Amendment violation, then we can proceed with that as a taking based on how people have lost their, could potentially lose their property. We can proceed based on a due process theory as well, based on the lack of notice and how this was brought about. So we have about 10 potential claims, and the end result is potentially a judgment against the village that's joined several with SMG for an amount 100 times more than any benefit from the deal with SMG. And I get paid, and they get their house. And that's where you're heading to. It doesn't make economic sense. I have other cases I'd rather take than sue the village and get paid by the village. But if it doesn't stop now, then there's going to be litigation, and it's going to be really, really expensive. And that doesn't help anyone but me. And I have better cases to take, so I hope that you could resolve this without litigation. I'm happy to tell you more about this, tell you more about the Village of Lisle case if you have questions. Ms. Wolf can find on Pacer the Lisle case, and that was, it had kind of a nutty judge, Shader handled it. But that's really lays it out. When the case came in, I was all excited, and it's a big intellectual thing, and it turns out somebody already did it. So it's just a matter of copy and pasting what happened to Lisle, and we can do that here. I don't know. Long story short, it's very easy to fix. Just, you know, don't force people to use one provider, and you can save an exceptional amount of money. So thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Greg Pilot. I'm joined this evening with my wife, Roxanne. We're the owners of the four flat on 1531 Balmoral Avenue. I'm sure the board committee had good intentions when they put this ordinance into effect. I don't dispute the need for safety, but I don't want to underestimate the financial impact this ordinance is going to have on both the landlords as well as the tenants. The last of the last 5 years, my wife and I lost money in our building, so we went to a negative position on a four flat. Other expenses like increased insurance and property taxes, as landowners, we pass that on to our tenants. Our tenants are now in a position of not being able to afford what we need to charge in order for them to stay in the places that we want them to stay in. We have wonderful tenants, and we don't want to see them having to go someplace else because they can't afford the rent. By the way, I do most of the maintenance myself, and I only hire contractors when there's something that I cannot do myself. So I would just ask the board and the committee to reconsider this ordinance as an economic impact to both the tenants as well as the landlords. Thank you.
Good evening to the board and everybody here. My name is Michael Plumtree. Some of you know me, some of you don't. Some of you like me, some of you don't. But that's beside the point. I agree with these guys as far as that, you know, you're looking out for safety, and that's, you know, that's appreciated. But in this case, we all think it's safe enough. These things go in at who you want. You better open up the police station and make that part of a food pantry too, because you're going to see a lot more people in there. I personally am on disability, and I know a lot of people in the neighborhood that are hurting, you know, and that's just the way it is. So I'm not going to take any more of your time up. We're against it. We don't think it's necessary. You have it.
Anyone else? Don't be shy. Anyone else? Come on up.
Are
protection services you can get from ADT and other services along that particular line, where they simply mail you the equipment. It's all wireless. It can cost somewhat less than $40 a month. And they not only include fire protection or collecting, getting information to the switchboard, but it also can contact the fire, because it's also a security system in its same right. So it's two for one if you want to have it. This expense is just crazy to have it this way. And it is so, like you said, over lopsided in that particular degree that it just smells of corruption from whoever started this.
My name is Roxanne Pilot, and with my husband Greg, we have the building at 1531 Balmoral, which is a four flat. One of my concerns in this process, and I won't repeat or go over some of the things that have already been said, but one of my big concerns from the beginning is that the communication on this has been very limited. We have, in Illinois, we have Open Meetings Act. There was no communication of what was being discussed, as others have pointed out, until the ordinance was passed. And so that makes it very frustrating as an owner, either of a single unit or of the entire building, to try and participate in government, which we certainly want to do today. And with all of the internet possibilities for communication, I think that the village can, on a different level, but it definitely has affected this issue. I think there's opportunity to improve communications with the homeowners especially of multi-unit buildings, or who work in conjunction with each other through a condo association, to improve communications. So that, the only time that we heard of this literally was through three certified letters that we got that were all copies, which we were happy to see at least that much communication. But no other, that we needed to do this, and here was the list of providers that we could choose from, and when it had to be done. And another piece of information that was actually just left in an envelope in the basket of our mailbox, the lower metal basket that holds mail, which a tenant thankfully picked up and retrieved for us. I really find it problematic that a village as old and as what I had thought was well working has kind of fallen short in terms of communication. We hear very little on anything from Westchester, from plumbing issues or sewer backup issues. And again, as my husband indicated and others have indicated, those problems are borne by the owners. And we wind up paying a good amount, and it's hard because we don't want to see that passed on to our senior tenants or to those of our tenants who have health issues. So I really urge you to consider both the fire department, the board, the village president. Please consider opportunities for improved communication with all the residents of the community so that we can participate in the governance of the community. Thank you.
People have raised a lot of very good arguments, I think, regarding the fire alarms. Nobody's saying they're bad inherently, but they seem to be overkill and not necessary and cost prohibitive for us. So what I wanted to ask along a little different line, what would be the process, or can you tell us which trustees voted for or against these things so that we can all keep that in mind next time we vote?
Well, I can respond a little bit to that, and the fire chief will—he'll be up next to explain the situation surrounding this. But the topic was brought up by our fire chief for safety concerns, and we put stuff in the agendas that we have, we posted, and I'm sure Jim wrote things about this in our newsletter over time. Now, I'm not sure if you get onto the newsletter via the website or if you see it delivered or whatever, but generally we try to hit as many topics as we can in the newsletter, and hopefully, you know, people will come. This is not a new issue, it's just that there's a lot more people here today than have been here in the past. We did receive some letters, and I think it was back in June sometime. You know, I went around the board and said, hey, I've got five or six letters, guys and gals. What do we want to do? Some people approached the board just like yourselves. And, you know, we re-sanctified what the fire chief was looking for as far as the safety and having an alarm system in the common areas that would be safe, so we would make sure if the alarm went off that everybody would hear it and everybody would get out safe as best as we can. The last thing anybody wants is for somebody, and even yourselves, that want to have a situation where someone gets hurt, killed, injured, or whatever, that there were no alarms. You've read the newspapers on other occasions where there have been fire deaths, and the alarms weren't working, and who took the batteries out, and all these other things. So, wait.
The audience, please reserve your comments.
You know what? I didn't interrupt you when you talked, and you're not going to interrupt me, okay? I didn't interrupt you. I'm speaking now. So, those kinds of things happen, and I would imagine that, you know, we're reasonable people here, that the chief asked for this to happen, direct connection, so we would be Johnny on the spot, as we are with the businesses. All the businesses out there have direct connections to 911 and the police and the fire and whatever, so we can get there very quickly. So that was the theory around this. Now, this is the first time that there's been this many individuals here that have voiced a concern about the ordinance, about the timing, about the costs. I know Jim has spoken to a number of people individually who had questions or who I handed a letter to say, Jim, this couple in this apartment building has a question. Can you field it? And that's that. So here we are today. We're trying to make your lives better. We're trying to make your lives safer. We don't want to be on the news that there were no alarms, there were no this, there was no that, and somebody got injured. I mean, that's the key to this. The board will certainly take all the information that you've given us under advisement, and if the board so wishes to rescind anything, we can. We have that power, okay? But we try our best to communicate. I don't know of all the associations. There's more associations here in the condo things that I've ever heard about. You know, you have the subdivisions on the west side of town that have meetings in the community room that share with us who the president of the Westchester Homeowners Association is. Personally, I don't know all your associations. We are not a home rule community that have registries for apartments like home rule communities do. They have fees, they have inspections, they have all kinds of stuff, but they know who the landlords are, they know who to go after when there's an issue, code violations and things of that nature. We don't have that ability because we're not a home rule. So if all of you have associations, I'm sure that the manager, the fire chief, and certainly our community development director would like to have that, because we try our best to give out as much information as we can. And if any one of you have read the newsletters over, we're the only community around here that puts out a monthly paper, albeit 15 days you won't get until the next issue because of our time constraints. But we try to put enough information in there, what we talk about from the board. I do some commentary on that as well, as does the police chief and the fire chief, to try to be more informed than any community here, sending out a four-page glossy four times a year. So, again, you're presenting something to us today. There has not been that many people before you doing the same thing. And for the attorney, there's some issues that you've brought up that I'm ignorant of. We have counsel that certainly looked at this ordinance before it even graced our presence and may or may not have had an issue with it that I'm aware of. So we'll be certainly looking at all those facts, and the board will ultimately make a decision of where we go from here. Can I give you an answer right this minute? Of course I can. That's going to be a discussion based on some of the points that you've brought up, the financial thing. But, you know, we're balancing it with safety, cost. We certainly understand, based on what has been said in the last 40 minutes, of what your feelings are. But for those who run associations, I would encourage you to make sure that we know who the associations are, because when these things come up, it's nice to send out an email to somebody, and then you can pass that along to your constituents who live in your buildings, because we don't have that ability to know who are the renters and all the addresses and all the names and all the whatever. The owner of the building obviously is responsible for generally the water bill. Sometimes as a courtesy, we send the bill directly to the homeowner or the apartment renter who has it, but ultimately the owners are the responsible parties, and sometimes we don't have all that current information. So that's the best I could tell you at this moment.
Okay. If I could just say two follow-up things. I do read the newsletter fairly thoroughly myself, yeah. And the first time I heard of this, it was a done deal. And I think a couple other people have said that they were not aware of it ahead of time, and I understand your, you know. The other thing is, you didn't answer my question about how do I find out who voted for or against.
We all did. We all did. That was kind of the...
There was a unanimous vote on that.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, the fire chief explained the situation. Okay. This wasn't at that meeting or the committee of the whole meeting where it was discussed first, mm-hmm. nor when the board passed it, nor when I brought this back in June. There was, you know, a few people that were here, and the chief explained the situation again to us, and I asked, does anyone want to reconsider this situation? And okay. We said that we were going to follow the chief's recommendation. Now, granted, there's a lot more people here today, a lot more people that are expressing displeasure orally, which is good to see. Generally, there's three people in the audience. So, you know, we need the feedback, either by email or letter or whatever. We try to answer it, and I'm sure Jim can explain on his end where this came from, why it came from, and quite possibly, if we had it to do all over again, it would have been nice to have all the associations at a meeting and let the chief present, and then the chief could have brought back some of that feedback to us, and then we could have made probably a decision based on everything instead of a portion. So.
Thank you.
Okay. All right.
Sir, could you state your name for the record?
Earl Ellison. This is for safety. Right now, I know there's at least two people who are probably going to die because of finances and their medical bills, okay? And like I heard, hasn't been a fire in, what, 20 years? Things are kind of off base.
Yes, ma'am.
I own a building.
Ma'am, state your name for the record, please.
My name is Agapita Gonzalez, and I'm the owner of a building in Balmoral Avenue. And my building has already an alarm system. So what's the difference with my alarm that is already installed and this new alarm that is going to be a lot of expenses for me, and I have to charge more money for the tenants that they really sometimes don't even pay whatever little money they are paying me, mm-hmm. because they are Section 8 that they get paid from the city, and sometimes they're 3 or 4 months behind, and I have to make my mortgage payment on time. So it's kind of hard for me to spend this kind of money and just one time, and later these tenants, they're barely all the updated that we have to keep doing. I know it's for safety, but what's the difference between the alarm already installed and this new alarm? Is it a cheaper one that we can get, or we have to get just this expensive ones? And plus also the monthly fee.
Yeah. I don't know, because I don't know what kind of alarm you have. That's certainly a question that the chief could answer or ask. But we'll get to the chief when we're done with all the people that are talking, and maybe your question could be answered. Okay?
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Claudia Moore. I manage 10 buildings in Westchester, 4 flats. A couple salient points. All of our buildings have hardwired smoke detectors, carbon monoxide detectors, and emergency lights. They are checked every year by Frederickson Fire Department. We also have fire extinguishers in each building that are checked every year and maintained. I have been in touch with the fire department since the first letter came out, trying to explain that we have all this, that we simply cannot afford to do this. It has fallen on deaf ears. I don't know whether you were aware that we had all of this more up-to-date equipment in our buildings. You know, you say, oh, somebody stole the battery. Somebody can steal a battery. If it's hardwired, that's not really going to matter. So, I mean, just a few things that, you know, didn't seem like they were addressed properly tonight and that you guys should be aware of before. And also, one final thing. When we got the newspaper last month, it said that they had changed the ordinance to address 5 or more units. We were thrilled. And then I was told that no, that was a misprint, and that they really meant to say 4. Well, the ordinance, in actuality, says 3 or more. So, I mean, I don't even know where your stand is on the ordinance right now. But, you know, there are things that do need to be addressed before this is put into, you know, we're going to fine you $750 a day if you're not compliant.
Thank you.
Scott Ryerson, I have one more thing to add. Even if these alarms were in place tomorrow, as if by magic, I know that the 40-unit owners in my association, I would have to increase their assessments. My point here is this is not a sustainable thing. This is something that will go on forever and ever and ever, that we will have to pay whatever the name of this company is, SMG, we have to pay them constantly. And it's like the water bill that keeps going up. This is gonna keep going up. Okay, we have to provide our community, our unit owners with water and basic safety. We have all these safety things on every floor. Even in the basement, we have fire smoke alarms and carbon monoxide detectors. So my point here, I just want to add that this is not a sustainable thing. Even if we were to put in, I would have to special assess each unit owner $2,500 in order to put these fire alarms in these buildings that we don't need. We can't afford them. As it is now, I have to make considerations for unit owners who cannot pay their assessments to date right now. So if I have to raise it up another $50 a month, I'm going to have a whole lot longer list of unit owners that are not paying, which lays the burden on the rest of us who do pay. And this fire alarm company, you know, they're going to update their systems. Every year they want to inspect them. We just don't see where we would be able to keep up with the cost. And that's the whole thing boils down to, and I'm sure you guys all know, you're businessmen, it boils down to money, the bottom line. We don't have it, and you cannot get blood from a stone. Thank you.
Evening, Mayor.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor. Madam Clerk, Richard Sheck, 3040 Hunt Club Drive in Oak Brook. I'm simply here because I'm Judy's husband. So that's why I came. But I can give you a little, and please don't take this as criticism of the board or anything. First, I want to compliment the chief very much because he's here to watch over all of us. He's here to watch out for us, make sure we don't get hurt. Your fire department is great. These people are not here on a complaint about performance or anything. Kudos go to you, chief, for openers. We did this three times in North Riverside when I was the mayor. Coincidentally, I had three chiefs because I was there for 20 years. Maybe I couldn't get it right, I don't know. But anyway, I'm saying the chiefs, our chiefs, what I did is I did the same thing you folks are doing tonight. We brought the people in, talked to them. This is a hardship for a lot of folks here. I believe it's an overkill too, and that is not critical, chief, because I know what you're looking for. I think I do, and I'm pretty sure. But I would say the bottom line here is that there's a whole bunch of people that are comfortable with the fire department and the chief. I think that's number one. You've accomplished that. You're not talking to 50 irate people that are saying there's bad performance. That's not the case here tonight. The case is an issue of overkill. And I think that's the case. That in all three cases that we had, this is exactly what we ran into. It was a hardship for folks. And now with the economy being the way it is, they simply can't afford it. So I appreciate you bringing it up, Mayor, and you hit it right in the head. Your job and my job was to bring up the issue. Let the folks make the decision. They know how to do it. And you made a good attempt at it. Thank you very much for the opportunity.
You know, while I have you here as a mayor that spent 20 years in the seat, what was there any resolve other than a blanket, trash it? Was there some accommodation that you were able to do over your time with the chief to kind of accomplish the goals of safety and upgrading of alarm services, and whether it be hardwire or lights or strobes? I know we've just went through that in this building here as well in my tenure here, with the strobes that you see on the walls and all those other things. Were you able to, come to some type of resolution that serviced both sides of the coin? And that this is a rhetorical comment.
Why, sure.
Of you, I haven't served with you. You were gone as I was coming in, but certainly, I will learn from masters like yourself and Joe Tamburino, who have warmed the seat a lot longer than me.
I appreciate that comment. Yes, we did. What we did is we decided to have our inspectors from our fire department go to each multifamily house for a close inspection to see if they were covered. I heard a lot from these folks tonight. They have a lot of equipment. I know what my wife has in her four flat. And if they felt that was adequate up to a normal or above standard, we gave them the approval, et cetera. Then we did find a lot. Matter of fact, we found our fire department didn't have enough smoke detectors in there. So that was a hard one to swallow, right, chief?
Mm-hmm. I'm actually going to look to put in fire alarms and sprinkler systems in my firehouse by April 27th.
There's no doubt in my mind. Because again, you care for us. You care for us.
I do. I live in this town.
I don't think there's any question in this room that man doesn't care for us.
I live in this town for 20 years.
It shows. It's simply, and it's not simple in your department. You're doing your job. Mr. Mayor, that's exactly what we did. We sent our inspectors out and made sure. And there were a lot of houses we didn't catch. And that we thought, my resolution always was, we might have not done something right sometime, but we're gonna do it over, and we're gonna help them. And the hardship cases, you guys experience that all the time. People can't pay their bills because they just don't have the money, and you work out payment plans for them. But I'm saying we did resolve it by that because we went to every single multifamily building and went through it and recommended to them if they didn't have smoke detectors, we probably like you folks, we gave them away. Took care of them. So that's how we resolved it.
Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you very much. I
I just got one or two more things to say. Again, this is Michael Plumtree. I'm not going to talk about where we can't afford it. I know the Westchester Fire Department does one heck of a job. Okay. 3.5 years ago, if it wasn't for them, I wouldn't be standing here today. I had something happen to me, and I had to go to a hospital in an emergency. So I know they're looking out for our health, and I just want to say thanks, and I hope you're enjoying those wings when I get them to you guys once a year, and, you know.
So thank you. Chief, would you like to follow up with some comments this evening?
Thank you, first and foremost. I'm not going to get on a soapbox here, but that's kind of what makes our country great, because we can all come out and speak our minds and everything. Thank you, Mayor. I greatly appreciate that. I do live in town for the last 27 years by choice. It's not a requirement of my job. I've raised three kids. Still raising three kids, and I love living in this town, and so I have a stake in this town. I was taking some notes here so I can try to answer as many questions as possible and as quickly as possible. And beyond this, please call me. I have no problems meeting you at your house, condos, apartments, whatever. I'll come out and talk with you if you want more time to talk. But real quick, first and foremost, it's to save lives. At the end of the day, I know it's a burden, it's a large expense, but if it saves one life in this town, I don't care how much I don't care. That's what the purpose is. Second of all, September 13th, 3:00 in the morning, if it wasn't for our officers driving by on Mannheim Road, southwest corner of Mannheim, we had an attic fire. Those people would have been in grave danger if it had not been for Officer Newton driving by at 3:00 in the morning, happened to see smoke coming from the attic. 8 months earlier, we have had a kitchen fire. I believe it was one of the units on Balmoral, again, about 8 months prior. So we do have fires in your units. Something that helped with that unit was it did have a fire extinguisher right outside the door. Thank goodness it was able to handle the fire. If it wasn't able to handle the fire, that occupant possibly could have been overcome by smoke until somebody else would have discovered the smoke detector going off, made the call to us. There would have been a delay, possibly a death. So it happens. It's a reality. Along with that, the quick response times, the way these systems are designed, we're asking it to be requiring it to be NFPA 72 compliant, which is the standard for fire alarm systems, requiring pull stations, the emergency exit lighting, the hardwired monitor smoke detectors. That being because if there is a fire, instead of warning your neighbors and getting and making phone calls, because a lot of people have a tendency to be doing it from inside the building, which is wrong. You can immediately exit the building, pull a pull station. We are immediately notified that there is a problem there. These systems have a fail-safe that are built into them. If there is a problem with the alarm system, we do get a trouble alarm. Trouble alarm is exactly that. It is a trouble alarm. There's something wrong with that alarm. We come out and investigate, find out what the problem is. A lot of times it's a battery backup that's in the system that's down, or an interruption of the power for some reason, or possibly the wireless had lost communication temporarily. Most cases, the wireless has worked really, really, really reliable in town. With that early notification, obviously, people are warned early to get out of the building quicker. You guys actually bring up the most valid cases why the fire department wants these put in the buildings is because many of the occupants are not able to get out quickly and efficiently to exit the building. So early notification is huge. So that right there in itself is one of the greatest importance of it. The early notification notifies us to get there, help you guys to evacuate or get out of the building to tell us when we do pull up with as much get out of the building. If everybody's out of the building, we can actually get to work putting the fire out and mitigating the problem. This creates less property damage, which in turn creates less time out of your units, which if you are a landlord, in many cases, people are displaced from anywhere from 6 months to a year while things are being rebuilt. During that time, many people end up relocating, and you lose the time. During that time, you're not collecting rent, and you're not. And if they do end up seeking residence elsewhere, you now have to fill that brand new apartment. In many cases, insurance companies give you discounts because you have a 24-hour monitored system. I sat here patiently, and I tried to take notes so I can answer as many questions as possible. As far as the outside of your building, the outsides of your buildings are constructed really solidly. Nowadays, the problem is what we put inside the buildings. Inside the buildings contain a lot of man-made materials, hydrocarbons, polyesters that create god-awful smoke, and the fires burn hotter and quicker than they ever have. Another reason why people can be overcome by the smoke and flames really quickly. The code does read poorly. It actually doesn't say three or more units. It actually reads more than three units. That's a code that is written by International Fire Code. All codes are written in kind of a backwards way, but we take it word for word because the lawyers have looked through everything. So actually, the code itself reads more than three units, basically meaning four units or more. We have sent out three certified letters. The first one especially saying, please bring your concerns to the fire chief or my fire prevention bureau. I've actually had a couple of people show up before a meeting to talk in the open forum, and I've talked to them before the meeting, and I've welcomed them, and I've welcomed them when I talk to people away from here to come to the open forum and please bring your concerns to the board. And actually, this is the first night since that last meeting in April of 2015 anybody has actually spoken publicly, I believe. I don't know if we've had anybody spoken publicly yet. Last but not least, that lawsuit that you bring up, it was with the Lyle Fire Protection District, which is different from a municipal fire department. They have a different, their authority comes from a different area, and that's what those courts had found, they didn't have that authority to enforce that rule. So that actually comes from a fire protection district, which operates under a whole separate set of statutes. I think I tried to address most of everybody's concerns.
What if anything, makes SMG unique in qualified to provide this service compared to other providers?
Before I was fire chief, back in 2007 or 2008, When the decision was made by that fire chief and that board sitting at the time, decided to go to a wireless system. There was actually, I think, only two to choose from at the time because it was a fairly new technology. But they found that system to be actually the least expensive wireless system. And actually, at the time, that fire chief and board decided to go with them and actually take the entity that was being charged the least amount of money and actually go with that price. So that is actually the cheapest price. So actually, in many cases, people ended up paying less for their wireless fire alarm system, and that's why SMG became the main provider. As far as installing, we come up with a list of 14 licensed in-town contractors, but we tell people there's many more you can get on the website. And we're not recommending them. These are just some that are out there just to help. Because we know it's an overwhelming task when people are not familiar with this.
The majority of fire alarm companies I've spoken to said they won't install it because they're not allowed to provide the service. So
That's their policy, then. Yeah, so that I can't help. But I know the list that we put out, nobody has said that to us.
Just in the future, if you are going to comment, please come to the microphone so that we record your comments.
I'm not very good at speaking at the microphone, but I think what we have, can you hear me?
Yeah.
I think what we have right now is very ideal. I think we have a lot of intelligent people here.
Yeah.
99% of them here. We're not idiots. We're not stupid. And I'll be frank with you, this is like a really like a ripoff. Yeah. Say what you want. I don't care. That's the way it is. We have a good thing going. Let's not ruin it. Another thing is the way the economy is going for the last 40, 50 years. And right now, with this administration, for the 40, 50 years, a lot of people are leaving the state of Cook County and the state of Illinois, over 100,000, and still leaving. If you want to raise these taxes, you're going to be here all alone. Because people can't afford it. There are not jobs available. Where we can afford this kind of $50 a month hike, where do people come from? Where? Are you all there?
I appreciate your comments. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Rita Calero. The reason why I want to come up here is because I'm listening to all this, but it's still not telling me what to do. I don't have $2,000. Am I going to pay $74 because I don't have $2,000? What do I do? They came and put it in. They put the alarm system in. I didn't even vote on that. I didn't even know anything about it. I knew it 3 days before that they were putting it in. And my association went and made a loan at a bank. I mean, what am I supposed to do? Could you tell me what to do?
I unfortunately don't have the answer. Unfortunately, I don't have the answer to that, and I'm not sure how your association rules are set up.
Yeah, but what am I supposed to do now that alarm system's in there and I don't have $2,000 to give to this alarm company? Nothing, right? Nothing.
Discuss it with your association.
My association?
No, I'm sorry. I said it's a discussion you need to have with your association.
I did, but it didn't work either. So I guess either they'll put a lien on my condo or throw me out. I never saw a man cry. I mean, I saw a man cry. He was so afraid they're gonna throw me out. They're my condo. I never saw him cry. This is terrible. This is sickening. This is disgusting. I had an alarm system in my home before I got here. I paid nothing to put it in. I paid $25 a month for the service, and it was straight to the fire department. So I don't know what you are talking about here. I don't understand any of this.
Earl Ellison here. Safety is one thing that can get way overboard. I mean, I don't know whether you shave with a blade or with electric razor. Sometimes don't act so worried that you're going to cut yourself to death or get electrocuted. I mean, that's the kind of thing we're talking about here. Careful when you walk outside. Make sure you conduct the meteor. We don't want to be this safe. It's too expensive. It makes no sense.
And you're embarrassing yourself. Okay, before we move on to the rest of our meeting, is there any other comments, please? Okay, we'll close the public comment and go into our... Okay, sorry.
Again.
Didn't see you get back up.
Suggest that you leave everything as it is. There is nothing wrong with it.
because somebody's got some kind of a brainstorm. Let's knock it off. Leave it as it is. People have no money. When we get the percentage down to 15% instead of 53% that we pay every year, then we'll have more money to play with. But we did that 15% tax, not 53%, or whatever. So, and also there are a lot of you that don't have to be there. A lot of politicians are getting paid for nothing, and we're paying for it. And I'm getting tired of it. I think so are a lot of other people too. $200. I have a hard time making ends meet right now. I got a family, I have 3 children. And I don't need this. Where somebody gets a nightmare, all of a sudden, let's raise taxes. Thank you.
Anything else before we close public comments and move on to the rest of our meeting? Once, twice.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Reza Ebadi. I live in 1521.
Would the audience please hold your comments?
Avenue. And I've been just working. I had no idea what was happening, and I had to work until 7 o'clock. And I was rushed to get in here to just say, this, whatever it is not really fair. Someone like me who works so hard, you know, and these expenses for me, it's life and death. So however way you want to do this, it's fine. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Wait, is this young lady walking up? No?
No, she's
not. Okay. Well, thank you all for coming and sharing the information. The board will be digesting the information that has been given today, both orally and in written, and we'll go from there. So I want to thank everybody for their time, effort, and energy this evening. Okay.
George Tichek, 1525 Manor. When will you make your decision, and if you make it, would you post it someplace where we all can read and see it?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And like I indicated before, if you do have associations that we could get some connections to for information, we'd love to have them. It's as simple as that. But yeah, absolutely. All right. Seeing any other public comment? If not, we'll move on to our consent agenda. Our consent agenda is approval of record of bills ending 9/21/16 in the amount not to exceed $616,892.03. Approval of minutes of September 13, 2006 of the board, also of the Committee of the Whole, also of executive session, all of September 13, 2016. Item C, a resolution authorizing the execution of an agreement between the Village of Westchester and Crawford, Murphy, and Tilly for engineering services related to the development of a hydraulic model of the water distribution system in the amount of, is that not to exceed $45,000 or is it $45,000? Not to exceed. So we'll add that in there, not to exceed $45,000, if those would make a change to that, on item C. Does anybody need anything pulled out of A, B, or C? If not, a motion and a second to approve.
Second.
Tommy?
Second.
Nick? Anything pulled? Hearing none, Jessica, motion and second to approve.
Aye.
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 Aye. Motion carries. Items A through C are approved. Item number 7 under our active agenda, an ordinance waiving competitive bidding and authorizing the execution of a contract between the Village of Westchester and Visions Constructions and Roofing LLC for roof repair services to the village-owned property located at 10240 West Roosevelt Road in the amount of $139,500. Just a comment regarding that. If you recall, we did have bid openings for the roof repairs in the amount that was $300,000 and pretty close to $400,000. This was another roof company that we sought to get some bids on a different type of mending other than a full-blown tear-off replacement. And we need to get this done as soon as possible for the post office, et cetera, with our weather in coming up on winter. So with that, there's a motion and a second to approve item A.
So moved.
Second.
Nick? I'm sorry, Frankie? Did you guys talk about this on the committee of the whole?
Yeah, yeah, roof the whole presentation.
I wasn't here last time, so I'm not sure. Okay. All right, so there's a motion and a second on the floor for the approval of the roof repair in the amount I've stated. There's a motion and a second for approval. Jessica, the roll, please.
Trustee
Stecker?
Aye.
Trustee
Perry?
Aye.
Trustee
Celestino?
Aye.
Trustee Rita?
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Thank you all. Janet, anything from the manager's perspective?
I have nothing to report this evening.
Miss Melissa?
Nothing.
Anything?
To report. Thank you, Mayor.
You're welcome. Board members, Frankie?
I have nothing new to report for economic development.
Nikolai?
My usual spiel. I just hoping to try to get the fourth guy in the firehouse. Hopefully the chief has had some discussions with Janet to try to get that going.
Celestine?
Nothing this evening, thank you.
Carl?
I'll save my comments for during the committee of the whole meeting, please.
Angela?
Nothing this evening.
Tommy?
Nothing.
Nothing. Chief?
good evening, and everything in the police department is going well. I just want to remind people, if they haven't read the newsletter last month and this month, that I am hosting a Citizens Police Academy beginning on Wednesday night, October 5th, which will run for 10 weeks, 3 hours every night on Wednesdays for 10 weeks. And I would like to encourage anybody that wants to see how the police department functions, how it works on day-to-day operations, if you wish to learn about certain topics such as gangs and drugs and SWAT and terrorism and DUI patrols and things like that, all the workings of a police department, as well as going on ride-alongs with our officers. I encourage you to go to the website, download an application, and fill it out and turn it on in. There's still plenty of time to get in. We've got about 12 or 14 going right now, and that's going to be a fun class. So if you got Wednesday nights available and you want to come out and hang out with the police department and learn all about it, then come on out. We're excited to have you. Thank you. You'll probably barely make it. It's 18. So it's 18 years old.
You'll need your birth certificate, though, because he don't trust you. So.
Pretty much heard enough from me, but we had three new guys start, Brian Chapp, Eric Micah, and Brandon Basic, our new firefighters. First couple days are always paperwork and administrative stuff to knock out, and but seem like a couple of good guys, or three good guys, and so far so good, and we'll keep rolling here. So,
Jim, also we don't have another meeting before your open house.
Oh yeah, I was gonna say that. Sorry, my mind's in another place right now. Yeah, October 13th, it's a Thursday night at 6 p.m. at the fire station over here on Roosevelt. We're having an open house. Fire truck rides, burn demo. We're going to do hot dogs and chips for the kids because it is a weeknight, so it's kind of nice to not have to worry about feeding the kids. So bring them out, no charge, and it's usually a good time. And come out and learn some good fire tips.
Chris, you're up.
In regards to finance, before you are the financial results for the first quarter of the fiscal year, which covers the months of May through July. On a straight line basis, the Village of Westchester is 25% through the fiscal year. In regards to revenues, when you look at the report, the general fund has collected approximately 19% of budget revenues, which is below that 25% threshold. However, that deficit is misleading, is that the village collects revenue sources at different times a year, specifically property taxes, which makes up the majority of the general fund budget and are collected in August and March. A couple accounts I wanted to point out for utility taxes, the natural gas, I had put in the report. The trends in the marketplace the last 3 years, gas prices have steadily decreased. Some good news, the last 2 months they have started to tick up a little bit. So based on some articles I've read, they're hopeful to see an increase throughout the rest of the fiscal year in tax cut. Hopefully those revenues bounce back a little bit. Police fines, we've already collected 80% of the budget through the first quarter. That's mainly due to the debt recovery program, which ties into tax time, which April 15th, so we usually collect the majority of that money in the first quarter. However, in comparing year over year, we're $55,000 above the collections from the same period a year ago. In regards to expenses, we've discussed at length regarding the overtime wages in fire. Hopefully now with the three new firefighters that have started, that'll kind of cut back a little bit. And then the last account, postage in the utility fund. Currently, we're averaging about $2,700 a month in postage, which will play out to about $32,000 for the year. The account was budgeted for $15,000. I think this was just an oversight during the budget on the fact that we went to monthly water billing, and I don't believe this was ever looked into at that point. And I just, for me, that concludes the report, but I going forward in a few months, I'd like to start giving you guys monthly data. I think it'll be more beneficial than trying to do this on a quarterly basis.
I'd prefer that too, actually.
Yeah, so my hope is by the end of the year, I want to get some other things organized, but hopefully by the first year, I've told President Puglia that we'll start getting monthly data.
That'd be great.
Yeah. If there's any questions.
Sorry, anyone have a question for Chris? Go ahead, Celestine.
Can we could possibly email the water bills?
Yeah.
I mean, everybody now knows they get them monthly. If they choose
but
to
the
have
seniors.
It emailed instead, let them have a choice.
That actually a resident asked today if they could go online and get saved on the postage. It's something we could look into.
I think we should.
Trustee Perry's point, maybe half the town might want to do it, half may not. It's a possibility, though. We could definitely look into it. And I could talk to Third Millennium. And
something needs to be looked at. That's twice the budget for that item.
Well, like he said, I don't think we raised it when we were going to add all those three times the postage. Yeah, I'd go email.
I mean, the question is always, has someone received the email that they didn't get the email or whatever? But I think
you could just go online and pull it up.
Right, but I think that we have to be exact to a certain point that we would print in the newsletter that you should be receiving your bills on the X day of October, of September. Of, you know, I mean, so people know to expect when that bill is coming, whether it's email or whatever. So, you know, the question is, we always get the info. I didn't get it. I didn't see it. I lost it. Or, you know, those kinds of discussions, especially when they're late, and then there's potentially a late fee added to that. So all I'm suggesting is that we be very succinct in telling people when they should be on or around receiving that email. So hopefully they'll get. I mean, there's times that Janet sent me email that never even made it to me. I mean,
well, we could tell the residents also, you're due the same time every month.
Yeah.
If for whatever reason you don't get it, you can go on the auto pay and see what
and
you
take
owe.
A look.
Yeah.
I just want to cover
if
all
I
the bases.
If I pay my bill at work, I just go online to see what I need to pay.
Okay. Not an issue. Just want to make sure we're solid with it. That's all. Before we change gears. So, Gregory.
Was everyone done with Chris?
Oh.
Just want to make sure I know it was kind of open.
Okay. Anybody want to beat up on Chris anymore?
Yeah. We were doing that before you walked in, too.
Most of my stuff will be in the committee of the whole. Just two things, date-wise. October 22nd, I found out today that we are added to the drug collection through the DEA program again, something that I've held out, finding out on. I sent some information into them, did not receive a response until today. So we are part of that. It's an October 22nd collection. And possibly because of the Walgreens collections, not necessarily ours, but others, and some other programs that are going on locally, our collection's been down dramatically. Where it's still here. We do still have it in our lobby. For those who don't know, we have a prescription drug collection program. Don't throw them down into the toilet. We have it in our lobby. On another note, I was actually going to mention some things regarding debt recovery that Chris sort of touched on, but just overall, the program itself, was able to tally the numbers. All told, $405,000 has been withheld. Some of it has not reached us yet, but $405,000 was withheld overall, with 3,400 people that were withheld on. And overall, with regards to the protesting numbers, those who have protested and we have found to be invalid in needing to collect their money, it's less than 0.1% overall. So a large number of people went into the system. Some of them have been withheld. Just as a matter of record, though, 0.1%. I was working on it with the state recently to get that number, trying to find out how many people protested versus how many collected from overall. But that's where our numbers stand today. That's all I have.
Robert.
Many of you are aware that we had one of our lighting circuits go out, just to keep everyone informed. What we call Circuit Q, which is from Cermak up to Canterbury and Gardner to Newcastle. There's some 50 lights on that circuit. We had placed inside our circuits surge arresters and line conditioners. We didn't have that before, and we had spent about $60,000 placing those safety devices inside all of our circuit boxes. This was to protect the investment we had made in the LED lights that went up, and we lost one of the line conditioners. So we lost a $75 item, and I believe it protected a lot of these $650 lights. So that popped out. We were able to recover that circuit, and we're ordering a new line conditioner put in. So for about $100 of labor and $75 for the parts, the system that we had upgraded did in this case prove to save the expensive part of the lighting system. We are down for about a day, but they came in and reinstalled those lights. We bypassed until we get the new part and just hardwired that through the surge arrester that we have in there, a 25 kV surge arrester. So the system's still protected, and I just wanted you to know it's working well, and we're able to get that whole circuit back online within about 20 hours, and from time of notification to investigate what was wrong and then get the lights back on. And we didn't lose any of the $650 LED panels, and that's what they're in there to do. So that was a success, and just wanted to I got messages from just about every trustee that the lights were out. What are you going to do? Fix it real quick. And so we jumped on that, and we got that done with our emergency contract with Omega Lighting. So worked well. That's all I have.
Melissa.
Good evening. I just have a couple things. I met with the owner of Palmer Florist. He had come and addressed the village board regarding his sign and not being in compliance. So he came in and got the application forms to go before the Zoning Board of Appeals for his variation for the sign. Also, we're working on getting the Zoning Code Steering Committee together for their next meeting. We haven't met in a while, so we're trying to get back on track with working on that. Also, just wanted to remind everybody that on October 4th, the Economic Development Committee's Pride in 7 meeting for the Fountain Business District. It's going to be held at Gober Realty. It's going to be from 5:30 to 7. We're doing an after-hours event for that one. So any businesses in that area that are interested, please come out. And that's it.
Jessica, anything? Nothing? Just a couple of things. Kudos to the Public Works Department. I did send to the board some photographs of the several blowouts that we had on the 2500 block of Hawthorne on the water main that was there. We replaced about 44 feet of water line. There was a break that had two repairs on it already. And, of course, Murphy's Law, as soon as we fixed it, a couple of days later, there was another blowout just a little bit south of there, which caused some consternation, water loss, et cetera. Those pipes were put in back in the late 50s. And if anyone has looked on the side of the Public Works garage or in the back, you will see the considerable amount of holes in the pipe and the thickness of that. So PW did a great job and saved us a lot of money in doing that, as contracting that out would be very expensive. You've all probably passed Cermak in Mannheim and saw that the gazebo that we purchased with the non-home rule hotel motel tax. So unless anybody from the audience was staying at the Hampton Inn, the money's come out of that fund that could be used for tourism and things of that nature, which the gazebo looks great. Public Works and Company has put it up. They're in the process of getting the lights in. And you know, Greg's working on the camera issues and that. And we have a little path to it. So I'm hoping that in the future we will be hosting some events and making that a location or a destination spot for the village, like we have the fountain and the memorial clock that's there as well. Leaf bags are being delivered. We got a host of them with the help of the Boy Scouts last weekend. That's out. We probably have about, I'd say, maybe 12 sections of about, I would say, 150 to 200 homes each left to do in various locations of the village. If you can help out in the future, we'll get those out as well. Our next shredding event is the 8th?
8th.
Saturday the 8th. Starts at 9, ends at 11:30. This one's going to be a little bit different in as much as we're going to have shredding there as well. So if anybody has bags of paper and shredding and important documents that they want shredded, you could actually sit there and watch them be shredded. Additionally, we are going to be collecting usable footwear and a donation to a pet society that's going to do something with the shoes to help pets. In addition to the electronics event that we host on that Saturday, we're going to wing it and see if we're going to hold anything in November, weather permitting. So I'm not committing to one at this point. However, today I attended a regional meeting out in Kane County of electronic recycling and what everyone from Lake County to Kane County, DuPage County is doing. And I don't think there was any clear consensus of anything, but our program is working a whole lot better than anybody else's program that is out there. So I wasn't about to share the name of what vendor we have, so I kind of kept my mouth shut. But it seems that the trend of starting to charge for television sets only is becoming discussed and possibility the trend. So in other locations outside of Westchester, and we only collect Westchester equipment now, it's $25 for a television up to 21 inches and 35 anything bigger than that. And Burr Ridge is going to be a collection site, and that information is going to be in our newsletter coming up. But this was verified today by a number of communities in Lake County and DuPage County that they're looking to charge for this. And that herein lies the discussion. The state of Illinois, as you all well know, passed a law in 2008 that 17 items of electronic in nature could not be tossed in a landfill. They had some money set aside to offset some of the cost with that, but as you well know, with the budget situations and the sweeping of different monies from different funds to fund other things, that some of the money was lost in this regard. So they've kind of left us with a holding the bag. You can't throw it away. You can't put it in the garbage. And you got to figure out what to do with it. Westchester's been fortunate that we've been collecting for 5 years or so, albeit after our earlier recycling event in April that had several hundred cars and kind of overtaxed the workers and residents, and cars were everywhere backed up to the Drake Oak Brook and Cermak and Wolf trying to get in, that we had to limit it to Westchester only. So we're going to follow through with our program. So far, so good with that, but I did want to say that we're going to do shredding as well, collecting shoes. Food pantry items are always welcomed at any of our locations, and kudos to all the helpers that are there, especially our troops 1 and 73 from the Boy Scouts and from St. Joe's and Proviso West, who provide service hours that we need to accommodate this. So with that being said, I don't have anything else in the president's report at this point in time. Do we have an exec sometime this evening?
Yes, we do.
And for which one or both?
We have both, and I would like to get collective bargaining.
Collective bargaining. Okay. So at the conclusion of our committee of the whole meeting, if the board so desires, we will go into executive session under 5 Illex 121(c)(1) to discuss appointment, employment, compensation, performance, or dismissal of specific employees of the public body. Item B, 5 Illex 122(c)(11), litigation when action against affecting or on behalf of a particular public body has been filed and is pending before court or administrative tribunal, or when the public body finds that the action is probable or imminent. I'm sorry. And 5 Illex 122(c), notation for collective bargaining. I don't have it committed to memory. But the collective bargaining issues, that these are all allowable discussion items in executive session. So, with that, and is there a motion and a second to adjourn our board meeting?
Motion.
Second.
Celeste? Was that Angela? Mm-hmm. I'm sorry. Yes. All those in favor of adjourning our board meeting and moving into our committee of the whole meeting, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposition, say no. Our board meeting stands adjourned.